next messages to preach today. I tried to go in another direction, but it just keeps popping me back here. Is that okay? Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord!
Praise the Lord! I'm going to be preaching to myself today. Just about a week ago, I was doing some things and listening to a sermon, and the sermon just got my attention. It's not what I'm preaching today, but the sermon got my attention, and the Lord began to talk to me in that sermon. And I wanted to brush it off, Susanna, but you know, if the shoe fits, you gotta wear it, right?
Amen.
And so since that sermon, I've been having to check myself. I've been having to relook at things, and I just want the Lord to live my life. Amen.
Yeah.
I'd like us to stand and turn to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 2. I have a lengthy bunch of scriptures to read. I don't have a lengthy message, though. I know last week did, wasn't it amazing? I finished so early. You almost didn't know what to do, right? Wow, you were like, wow, what's up with Pastor? Well, I exhausted an hour sermon earlier today, so I don't anticipate myself being very long, but I anticipate hitting the nail on the head with the nail needs to be hit. I was going to say where the hell needs to be hit, where the nail needs to be hit. Jeremiah chapter 2, look at the neighbors, I'm so happy you're here today. Amen. I do also want to remind you, on January 23rd, if you are interested, please see me. The men's ministry in our district will be going to the shooting range. So our White Hollow pastor said he got all the guns. He said we're going to shoot the enemy. So I don't know what that really means. So if you want to go shoot the enemy with the other men, let me know and I can give you directions. But you have to be a man. It's a men's ministry thing. Okay? So on that day, all the women, you can stay home and wash the enemy. Okay, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I promise you, if you go, you're going to enjoy yourself. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 2, and I want to start with verse 20. I hope and I know that all of you came to the women's thing this morning. I hope and pray that you were blessed. Amen. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 2 and verse 20. For of old time I have broken thy yoke and burst thy bands, and thou saidest, I will not transgress, when upon every high hill and under every green tree thou wanderest, playing the harlot. Yet I have planted thee a noble vine, wholly a right seed. How then art thou turned into the degenerate plant of a strange vine unto me? This is the Lord speaking prophet Jeremiah about this people Israel, telling them that I've done so many phenomenal things for you. I've broken the yoke, I've burst the bands. You told me you would not transgress, you made vows to me, but still you play around. I planted a grapevine and a right seed, but yet the vine and the plant that's coming out is degenerate and strange. For though thou wash thee with nitre and take thee much soap, yet thine iniquity is marked before me, saith the Lord. In other words, you might look clean, but I know. That's what he's saying. How canst thou say, I am not polluted, I have not gone after Balaam? See thy way in the valley, know what thou hast done. Thou art a swift dromedary, traversing her ways. A wild ass mews to the wilderness, that stuffeth up the wind at her pleasure. In her occasion, who can turn her away? All they that seek her will not weary themselves. In her month, they shall find her. Withhold thy foot from being unshod, and thy throat from thirst. But thou saidest, there is no hope, no, for I have loved strangers, and after them will I go. I want to take my message today from verse number 26. As a thief is ashamed when he is found, so is the house of Israel ashamed. They, their kings, their princes, and their priests, and their prophets, saying to a stop, thou art my father, and to a stone, thou hast brought me forth. I think it is pretty sad to look at Israel and to recognize what God did, but for them to look at a stone and give the stone credit for bringing them forth. Look at a stump, looking at a stump, and saying, that is my father, and he is the father of all things. They had proved themselves to such a point that they were not giving the proper recognition to God that they should have. For they have turned their back unto me and not their face. But in the time of their trouble, they will say, arise and save us. But where are thy gods that thou hast made thee? Let them arise, if they can save thee in the time of thy trouble. For according to the number of thy sins are thy gods, O Judah. Thank you, Lord, for your word. I pray that you give us understanding of your word tonight, Lord. I pray, Lord, that you speak to us. Speak from the front to the very back of this church, Lord. I pray, God, that you open our minds and hearts to receive your word in this house. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And everybody say, amen.
Amen.
I want to preach tonight on the topic of when God goes silent. Say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
When God goes silent. I had some time to think about this. The Lord was talking to me the other day about some things in my own life. And you know, I said, yeah, I know, okay, so, no, I hear you, Lord. And it's one thing to hear, but it's another thing when he begins to bring it up over and over and over and over again. And I think sometimes we hear the Lord, but we do not fully take things serious until we have to take things serious. But I left that conversation with the Lord, recognizing that his goodness and his mercy surely does follow us all the days of our lives. But I left thinking to myself that all that I want to do for God, I cannot afford to blow it because of myself. When we look at this scripture in the prophet Jeremiah, we recognize that Israel had been blessed abundantly by God. We recognize that Israel had come through the Red Sea, Sister Kanani. We recognize that it was God's children that, as the enemy followed them, that God delivered them from many generations of Egyptian bondage. We recognize that as they were traveling and as Pharaoh and his army was chasing them down, as they could hear the clogs of the horses and the chariot wheels rolling and chasing them. When they came to the edge of the Red Sea, we recognize that even in the midst of their murmuring and in the midst of their complaining, can you hear me? In the midst of their murmuring and complaining, we recognize that still Moses lifted the rod and he stretched it out forth, and God parted the Red Sea. Not only did he part the Red Sea, but he buried the enemy after all of them crossed safely. It wasn't enough for God to bring them across safely, but God protected Israel, or the Hebrews, from the enemy following after them. Because what happened was, even though God delivered the Hebrews from Egypt, the enemy still chased them down. But God did not only want to deliver them, he wanted to prevent them from being caught again and put back into captivity. God led them across the Red Sea. We find that the hand of God caused when they moved in the wilderness for 40 years. We find that the Bible says a pillar of fire burns at night. You know that pillar of fire burning at night Kanani, that in the daytime there was a cloud that hovered over the tabernacle, and the cloud provided rest and shade. And we knew that when the cloud and the fire moved, that the children of God moved along and followed with it. God was so good to them that He not only delivered them, He not only drowned the enemy, but He provided shelter in the midst of their journey. God was so good to them that when they needed food, when they were lacking food in the wilderness and complaining again, that God gave them manna when they had no food. He had this wafer fall from heaven, Brother Carl. He had the quail fall from heaven, and it would supply their need for the moment there. He was so good to them, even when they complained and murmured. What a great God that we serve. That truly He is so wonderful and so great that I cannot tell it all. That when they had no water, the Bible says, Moses struck the rock and water came out of the rock. Even when Moses disobeyed the Lord and the Lord told him to not speak to the rock, still Moses strikes the rock and water still comes out even in his disobedient state. And God was just so good to them. If I could stand and just give everybody an opportunity to testify how great the Lord really is and how good He is, it would blow your mind how appreciative people in this house are for the goodness of the Lord. That we could truly quote and mean it when we say, surely goodness and mercy has followed me for all the days of my life. I cannot tell it all, Sister Sa'ol, how good the Lord has been to me in 2015. I cannot tell it all how good the Lord has been to me in the first 2 weeks of 2016. This first 2 weeks have blown my mind what the Lord has done. And Israel has been so blessed by God. He not only opened the Red Sea for them, He also opened the River Jordan for them. It was when they were on the brink of ending their 40-year journey, ready to possess the promise, that because of the time of the year, the water elevated and rose high. But the Bible says, this time Moses didn't stretch out his rod, but they were instructed to let the priests walk into the water. And the priests, as soon as they put their foot in the water parted. And everybody, because they had the ark of the covenant carried it, and everybody went through the River Jordan, and they set up rocks as a memorial for them. Praise the Lord. God always came to their rescue when they were in trouble. Isn't that just like the God that we serve? He always comes to our rescue when we are in trouble. I look at my daughter and that big thing that was on her neck, and we went to the doctor, and the doctor looked at her, and the doctor said, you know, you got to give her a shot, do all this kind of stuff. We went home, took the medication, thing was still there, kept praying for her every night. I would pray with her, and it eventually went down. But the doctor, you know, we might say, well, you know, thank God for medication. And I do thank God for medication, that there is an antibiotic that can kill a virus. But the doctor said something to me, and you know, God always has a way to interject into situations just to remind me that I am the one doing the healing. Yes, I can use this and I can use that, but it is me who is the real healer. The doctor said, you know, that could have been really, really bad, you know, and it could have caused some serious things, but we are so thankful. They don't say praise the Lord. So thankful that it wasn't as serious that it could have been. As a matter of fact, the doctor still now doesn't really know what it is because I never gave him a blood sample. You say what you want to say. Well, I'm her dad, so I made the decision.
All right.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
But I thank the Lord because of the hand of God.
Yes.
And I can see the hand of God.
Yes.
We are so appreciative of Him.
Hallelujah.
And this is what strikes me last week when the Lord was talking to me, that He is so good. He rescued Israel when they were in trouble. He loved them when they were unlovable. God only knows how much He loved me when I am unlovable. You you said it, Brother Archie, so undeserving. Praise the Lord. God took them, but all they could do was murmur and complain. You know, I preach about that, but we have no murmurers and complainers here, so none of us would understand that. Amen. But there came a day when God got tired of Israel rejecting him. I got a scripture for it to support him. I do know that he would never leave us nor forsake us. But even God himself got tired of the stench of sin and destroyed the whole world. Even the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord will not strive with man always, if all the days of his life. But there came a day that God got tired of Israel rejecting him. Simply because they did not recognize him as the one who brought them out of Egypt. How sad was that? That they did not recognize that it was the Lord who brought them out of Egypt. It wasn't Moses. It wasn't the water turning to blood. It wasn't the locust that was flying around. It wasn't the mysterious hail that dropped in Egypt land. But it was God that brought them out. People can say what they want to say, but deep down inside of us, we recognize what the hand of the Lord is doing in our lives and in our family's lives and the lives of them around us. Let everybody else say, oh, you was lucky. No, we were blessed by the Lord. Let everybody else say, you got a good break. No, we were blessed by the Lord. Brother Mara, you said it well the other day, that really, yes, you have a wonderful daughter who did wonderful in school, who made wonderful marks, who was the valedictorian, and we can credit that to so many things, but when we look really deep down inside, we thank the Lord for what the Lord had put in your lap and the wisdom that he had given you to instruct her and to raise her.
Hallelujah.
So Israel, God got tired, Sister Kanani, of Israel rejecting him because they didn't recognize him as the one who brought them out of Egypt. God, in essence, told the prophet Jeremiah, I'm sick of what Israel is doing. I pray. I know I make God sick in some stuff I do, but I pray that God doesn't get tired of me. I know for a very fact, Brother Archie, everything I do doesn't put a smile on God's face. I know for a fact, I'm talking about me, that I displease God and I disappoint God. But what I'm telling you is not that. What I'm telling you is that we don't want to get to a place where God gets tired of us and we. He wasn't only tired of them, but something had transformed in Israel's life that they didn't give God the credit for bringing them out of Egypt. That absolutely blows my mind. It is one thing to disobey God, but it's another thing to get to a point that we don't glorify God for the things that he has done. We don't recognize that if it had not been for the Lord. It's one thing to mess up, but it's a whole other thing to be at a point in your life that you no longer give God the credit anymore. You know, I've been consciously trying to change some of the words I say. Sometimes I don't want to say God is good. I want to say Jesus is good. Sometimes I don't want to say praise the Lord. I want to say praise Jesus. I don't want to be ambiguous in who I'm talking about. I don't want to be politically correct. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm not talking about God or the God or the Lord or whatever. I'm talking about Jesus. I want to train my mouth that when something good happens, that I say praise God that my daughter is good. I want to say praise Jesus. Yeah. Instead of just praise the Lord, I want to say praise Jesus what he has done. So God told Jeremiah, I'm sick of what Israel is doing. If I would confess to you last week when the Lord was talking to me, he didn't tell me in that word, but as I recollect and look back, that's really what he's telling me. I'm sick of them. Jeremiah, they say to a stump, thou art my father. We got a lot of tree huggers in this world now, you know. The Bible said they love the creation more than the creator. It ain't that fair to think that something possesses a tree. We have many cultures in the world who believe that trees are gods, and bushes are gods, and rocks are gods, and rivers are gods. This is not that far out. It's, God told Jeremiah, I'm sick of it, that what they are doing, they say to a stump, that stump, you're my father, but God said, I am the father. They say to a stone, you are the one that brought us out of the land. But God said, I am the one that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Be careful, Israel, because it wasn't a stone who brought the giant down. It was God who brought the giant down. And sometimes we can give credit to something else that we shouldn't give credit to. It wasn't the stone that brought the giant down. It wasn't the stone that brought deliverance. It wasn't the stone that was put in the river. It wasn't the priest's foot that was put in the water. It was God who did it all. This is what it says in Jeremiah. That's what he says. I found them. He said, I'm tired of them saying to the stone, you brought me forth. But God said, I'm the one that brought you out.
Yes.
This year, I want to reposition my thinking and your thinking that it's not all them, it's him.
Right.
It's him the one that is doing everything. It's he who can do exceedingly. It's he who can do abundantly. It's he who can do above all that we ask or think. God said to Jeremiah, he said, I'm going to say to Israel, Israel, I'm tired of you turning your back on me. That's what he said. There came a day when the children of Israel had fallen back into sin. It seemed very interesting to me that their priests and their prophets, the priests of Israel, the prophets of Israel, the kings of Israel, the princes of Israel, would all start out good, seemingly. They would all start out as good kings, Sister Buena. They would all start out noble, but somewhere they would get corrupted down the line. It's interesting to me that all these people, even the prophets, Sister Buena, would start out good and they would gain the confidence of the people. And God recognized that your priests, your prophets, your kings, your princes, all of them would gain the confidence of the people, and then they would betray them. The prophet Hosea said, sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground, for it is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. It is a prophetic statement that we got to break up all the hardness, Israel. Break up all the stuff inside of you. Break up all the excuses and the junk, all the stuff that life has a way to harden us. This world and our society with Archie is trusting in everything but God. This world trusts in everything but God. Just yesterday, my nephew pulled up, he raced into the parking lot downstairs, and I said, what's up with you? Where are you going? He said, Uncle Mike, I've been trying to call you, but I couldn't call you, so I just needed to come by the shop, and I just needed to ask you, please, pray for my baby. Because she went to the hospital today with bronchitis and all that. All I'm asking you to do is pray for her. You see, people know where they need to go to. People know where the right answers are. Not me, it's him. And it's not about me, because my prayer is not more powerful than your prayer. It's the God that we're praying to. And amen? And we live in a world and society that not everybody is rushing in this parking lot and saying, Pastor, pray for my child. Some of them are rushing to the doctors doing all that, and they're telling us 2 weeks later about things that went on. This world and this society is trusting in everything except God. In reality, we have it good tonight. You say, praise the Lord. I said, in reality, we have it good tonight, church. Praise the Lord. We might not be everything we want to be, but when we really look at it, in reality, we have it good tonight. God has been good to every single us. We have more tonight than we've ever had in our lives for many of us. There was a time that we didn't have it so good. Many of you probably tell your children how it was in times gone by that you haven't had this and you haven't had that. But when we look, the Lord is good to us. Sometimes it blows my mind how I can still buy food every day. Sometimes it blows my mind how God can provide and do this and do that every day. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
We have nice clothes. We have homes. We have vehicles, we have furniture, we have things in our possession, and all of that is good. But I've come to tell you, don't forget where it came from. You might sit here and say, I'm not going to forget that, Lord. I'm telling you this for a reason. And whatever the reason is, God knows, don't forget where it all came from. There were great prayer meetings in days gone by. Some of you have prayed on your knees for your children and have seen God do things that you couldn't even imagine. Others of you have fasted and prayed for people in your life and watched God do the miraculous. Watch God heal bodies. Watch God heal grandchildren. Watch God touch children. Watch God bring people safely from one airport to the next airport. We might not think much about that, but we cannot forget where all of this has come from. Many parents have prayed for their children and have calluses on their knees from so much prayer. When they were in trouble, it's you who called upon the Lord in the middle of the night and whispered the prayer, Lord, protect them on the way home. Lord, send an angel to keep them safe on the way home. You prayed when things were not going good for aunties and uncles. And we know without a doubt that God has heard your prayer. But today, people have turned their back on God. Proverbs said, happy is the man that feareth always, but he that hardeneth his heart shall fall into mischief. That's an interesting scripture. Happy is the man that feareth always, but he that hardeneth his heart shall fall into mischief. That's in the KJV version, Proverbs 28 and 14. Hebrews says, wherefore, as the Holy Ghost saith today, if ye will hear his voice, harden not your heart as in the provocation in the day of temptation in the wilderness. I want you to know, don't forget it. Don't forget what the Lord has done. But I want to take it a step deeper. God hears every vow that you make to him. God has heard every promise that you and I have made to him. Some of us have promised God a lot of things, Sister Joanna, but we don't do anything about it. But God has heard our vows. God has heard what we said when we was in this altar on our knees saying, God, forgive me, I promise. God, help me, and if you help me, I will. God, if you direct me, I will, and I can. If you open the door, Lord, I will walk through. We've prayed many of those prayers in here, but hear the word of the Lord tonight. As the prophet Jeremiah was inspired by God, God hears all of our vows that we make to him and the promises that we have made to God. And let us not fall victim of turning our back on the things that we have promised God that we would do. Are we perfect? Absolutely not. But God will not give us more than we can handle. But there are vows that we have made to him that it is within our ability to carry them out, Brother Archie. But we get cold and we get hard in our heart and we fall into mischief. There are vows that I made to God that I must keep to God that I haven't kept. There are vows when I told God, God, I will read your word every single day. And I'm recognizing now, Brother Talo, if I tell God that, I must keep my vow to him.
Amen.
The other day, I left my Bible in the store. And I told my wife, I said, oh, babe, I left the Bible in the store. She said, that's okay. We'll get it tomorrow. I said, oh, I feel like a little baby. No, but I want my Bible. And she said, it's okay. We'll get it tomorrow. And I said, no, just give me the phone. I can discipline myself to set aside time every single day. This is a daily walk, Brother Archie, and every day is not easy, you know. 4 days of the week might be easy, but the other day, there comes a day that it's hard and you don't want to get up, and you're recognizing that you like watching what's on TV because you got a lip sync challenge, and it's growing late, and you ain't read your Bible yet, and you want to just brush it off and say, I can catch up tomorrow, but you never catch up tomorrow.
Praise the Lord.
I'm talking about vows. And here I find myself standing before you, not just as your pastor, that's my calling, but I'm still a human being. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And God hears every vow we make to Him. You know, when you come into this church building in the middle of the night, you don't hear the air cons purring. You don't hear that either. You don't hear somebody in the corner praying, and you don't hear the pastor preaching and the keyboard playing and somebody clapping their hands. All you hear is dead silence. And you know, if you've ever come in the middle of the night into the church, there is a nice peaceful feeling, and there is also, Sister Puella, an eeriness about silence. You can drive down the road and you like silence and you hear the crickets start. And you step in the gas a little bit faster and you lock your doors. What a feeling sometimes when the church is absent of worship. There is no songs being sung. There is no people in here. Sometimes things can be so silent and in rain, it can be frightening. That's why you run and you lock the door. Nobody wants you to scare them. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
But when you go to the cemetery and stand by the grave of someone you love, it's silence. You look at the tombstone and there, next to the tombstone, you know what is beneath there. But there is nobody talking back to you. You might be one of those talk back and forth to them, but in reality, there's no voice coming out of the grave talking back to you. It's total silence. That's why none of you go to a graveyard in the middle of the night, because it's freaky, because there's nobody there, there's nobody talking, it's silent. And silence is freaky and scary and frightening sometimes. That's why your spouse says the thing you hate is when your spouse is silent with you. It's a weird feeling. But I gotta tell you tonight, there's something worse. Silence in the church. There's something worse, Sister Puella, than silence at the gravesite. What's worse is when God is silent. I hope to be able to call up Him and see that God is silence itself, Sister Puella. When we begin to wonder, God, why can't I hear you? In my mind, how do all this, what is happening? How do I have to wait? You know, there is a very big difference when you know it, when God says just wait and you don't hear nothing, and when you look behind not seeing nothing. And you begin to wonder, God, I need this answer now. My daughter is miles away, she's sick in her body, and I need an answer now because there's nothing I can do. I can't get a hold of her. God, I don't know what to do. Something is happening in Samoa, and I don't know, but the lines are busy and I can't go. You know that eerie feeling because you don't know what's happening. God, just give me, you know what I'm saying? God, give me a confirmation. And we search deep for a confirmation in our Bible. And you know sometimes? Silent. We've all been there. That's a frightening place. God goes silent. I want to read some verses to you, and I'm almost done. It's a lengthy verse, but listen to the Song of Solomon. Maybe you just listen to me as I read. I sleep. This is a poem in the Bible. This is not like Rice, what is her name? Or Angela Mayo or something. This is not a Hallmark card. This is like a real poem in the Bible. Song of Solomon. I sleep, but my heart waketh. It is the voice of my beloved that knocketh, saying, open to me, my sister, my love, my dove, my undefiled. for my head is filled with dew and my locks with the drops of the night. I have put off my coat. How shall I put it on? I have washed my feet. How shall I defile them? My beloved, put in his hand by the hole of the door, and my bowels were moved for him. I rose up to open to my beloved, and my hands dropped with myrrh, and my fingers with sweet-smelling myrrh upon the handles of the lock. I opened to my beloved, but my beloved had withdrawn himself. The door was open, and was gone. They opened the door, and they were gone with a towel. My soul failed when he spake. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. The watchmen that went about the city found me. They smote me, they wounded me. The keepers of the walls took away my veil from me. In other words, she was looking for her lover. And when she opened the door, finally, she took so long to open the door that he was gone. And she went throughout the city, Sister Buena, to look for him. And she ended up getting wounded in the city. She ended up people hitting her, beating her, and taking away the veil, probably raping her. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, that you tell him that I am sick of love. She couldn't find him, but he was not. But she had so many excuses. I gotta take off my coat. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. And he was knocking and knocking. And finally, when she was ready to open the door, he's gone. So the problem is, we think we have all the time in the world. Israel didn't have all the time in the world. There were times when they called on God and God answered them. There were times that God was tired of waiting for them to come. And when they needed God, they got destroyed by the enemy. They got overtaken by other nations. The world raped them and took them and pushed them in another direction. But it was nothing. Solomon said, I see, but my soul waketh. I hear the mouth of my beloved. Open unto me, my sister, my beloved, my Pharaoh, my undefiled. You are not dreaming. Dreaming of nothing. Some of us feel and hear the knocking of the Lord in our lives. We know that's him knocking for the power. We know that he turned into something, but it's not coming for us. And I want to tell you, contrary to what we say often, we always say he's always going to be there. I don't think so. This is what woke me up the other night, when God said, I'm not only going to be there to pick you up. You say, I pulled off my sandals and my robe, but your robe is right there. Jesus said in Revelation, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he the revelation says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. You see, you are not hallucinating, my dear friend, the thing that God is dealing with you about. I told the church today in White Pablo, and I'm beginning to say it more and I'm beginning to believe it more. I'm beginning to position myself in a place that this world is terrible. The things that are happening in this world is ridiculously terrible. Looking at Korea saying that they had an atomic bomb. Looking at missiles being fired by Iran after this treaty that was done. Looking at the things that China is doing. This is only the things we see in the news. There's many things we don't know. Looking at this free access and this attitude of nuclear weapons. Knowing very well that when God destroys the world, the next time it will be with fire. Looking at the time that we live in and the situations upon us. This is real. And in the midst, God is knocking at our door. Listen, we're not dreaming. The thing that he is pulling inside of us. We're not dreaming. This is really God trying to get our attention. And I shared with them today in my comment. I forget what I was going to tell you. I got so excited. But this is really people, I was sharing with them that with all of this that is going on, it used to in some ways worry me. It used to worry me, the laws that are passing and the way and things that are fighting Christians and the things that if it's not politically correct, Brother Archie, we gotta watch the P's and D's and Q's and the emails that we get sent, Sister Kathy, that we cannot talk about Jesus Christ in school. This is stuff we get sent in school. That you cannot wear a t-shirt that says Jesus now in school. And you cannot talk to any student about Jesus. All we do is just put it in the trash, right, Sister Kathy? We still do what we do, but all of this kind of stuff can begin to suck somebody and begin to realize that it's getting so dark. But what I have realized, Brother Archie, that statistically, many churches are declining. Statistically, many of the old line, hardline churches are falling back, and people are not interested in it anymore. But the churches that are rising are the Pentecostals. The Pentecostal movement is not falling back. It's increasing. And more churches are being added and people are being added to church. And I'm beginning to realize, Sister Quetta, it's because with all of this happening in the world, I was trying to tell her, I gotta start thinking like God thinks. I gotta try and not think like how I think. With all of this that's happening in the world, what's really happening is there's becoming a void in people's lives that cannot be satisfied with all the things in the world.
Right.
That people are being allowed to do all of these things in the world and it's causing a vacuum and a void. I've done that. I tried this.
Right.
I can do this.
Right.
And what it does, it leaves a void. And it's exciting me now because the darker our world is getting, the deeper the void is getting.
Right.
And that's why people are not interested in traditional churches. People are interested in something that can fill.
Yes.
That's why you're here today.
Right.
Something that can fill the void. This world wants a lot of suck stuff out of me. And the voids can only be filled by a real God. Amen. As I begin to hurry to a close tonight, we're not dreaming at the knocking at our door. The excuse was I pulled off my robe. The excuse was when that I didn't get to the door fast enough because I had to take off my robe. That's what Thomas Solomon said. I couldn't get there fast enough. And because I couldn't remove my robe to get there and get ready to greet you. You know what that really tells me? That Jesus is not my God. No excuse is satisfactory. What an excuse I have to pull off my robe. Some of us make so many excuses that we do so many things to be able to find the God. He's not my God. Someday we're going to run out of excuses. And I know this for a fact because as we become more apostolic, God becomes an apostolic difference. If you look at the early church, some people's excuses ran out really quickly. I don't want God silent on me.
Amen.
Saul, Brother Tim, had reached a place in his life that he couldn't hear from God anymore. As far as we are concerned, God was silent to Saul. It was not because God didn't answer his prayers, Sister Guerra. It was because Saul didn't reject him. And Saul couldn't hear God anymore. You know, God does. His mercy doesn't go forever. But if you're not careful, you get the message. You cannot hear him anymore, Lord Archie. You cannot distinguish. Is this me? Is this God? Is this the world? Some of us at this point can't even distinguish what is the devil or not the devil.
Mm-hmm.
We think everything bad happening in our life is the devil.
Sure. There are
bad things that happen that God allows, that God is doing something in your life, you know? It's not always the devil. We always think something that we don't like on the devil. It's not grace that his God will sign on to put you in. Matthew 13, the Bible says that Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me to bring me up? And Saul answered, I have sore distress for the Philistines to make war against me, and God has departed from me. Saul was so stressed out because the Philistine was coming after him again, and he was trying to ask God to help him to win the battle again. But he couldn't hear. He was saying, why has God departed from me? This is because I need you, God. Did I let before? I need you now. I need you. I need you. I need you. But God was seeming to have been a mile away from him. And the Bible says in 1 Samuel 28 and 15, and answereth me no more, neither by prophets nor by dreams. Therefore I have called thee that thou mayest make known unto me what I shall do. This is what happened. He said, I asked God to help me in the battle. There's no prophet that came to me that gave me direction, but that's how they depended on direction. There's no dreams that I had that gave me direction, but that's how it was dependent on it. You know what? He was looking for the confirmation, but he couldn't find it when he needed God the most. And he said, why is God turned silent to me? We wonder why he asked us to pull up and stop the witch of Endor. We wonder why a man would seek a witch when he died. And why? Because he couldn't hear from God anymore. And he wanted to seek something that he could get an answer from because God was silent on him. I can promise you, if you begin to seek direction in your life with him, and God is silent with you, you will be buying every Sunday newspaper, turning to page 38, and reading your horoscope, and looking for something tangible to grab, to hear, because God has gone silent on you. You know why we don't read horoscope? You know why we don't go and see palm readers? Because we don't need them to tell us what God has for us. Our God is not silent on us, Brother Archie. But I promise you, if he becomes silent on you, you're going to be looking all over the place. This is real why we've come today, Sister Saho. I don't want God to go silent on me. Sometimes we wonder what God will have to do to wake people up that has one time known the Lord. There's some things I've been thinking about for years. But do you know, 1 week ago, God did exactly what he needed to tell me to wake me up. 1 week ago, the Lord told me something. By woken me up a week later, I would be so easily woken up. 2 weeks later, and 3 weeks later, and 4 weeks later, but at least I recognize that it's a wake-up call from the Lord. What does God have to do to wake us up? And I close with this final scripture in Proverbs. Because I have called and ye refused. I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. But ye have said it not all my counsel, and would none of my reproof. Check this out. He says, I also will laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your fear comes. This is in the Bible, you know. When we all say God is loving and he's loving, but I tell you what, there's some stuff in this book that'll wake us up. That God is not playing games. When your fear cometh as desolation and your destruction cometh as a whirlwind, and when distress and anguish cometh upon you, then shall they call upon me. He said, when all this stuff, when all, everything, hell breaks loose, then you're going to call upon me. But he says in Proverbs 1 and 28, but I will not answer. I do not honestly think that any of us is in that place in our relationship with God right now. But I'm preaching this as a reminder to myself that it is not impossible to get to a place like that. Please don't think of the mercies of God. Please don't think because every time we can walk in here and we can feel His presence and tears run down our eyes that we've got it made. We hear the story, we see, we know the stories and all that, but you know, because it's never hit home for us, it doesn't really matter that much. And we can play with the mercies of God, but the Bible says that there are situations when it comes to a point that He says, I will not answer. They shall seek me early. but they shall not find me. You know, I do know what the scripture said, that he will never leave you or forsake you, Brother Archie. I do know how to repent and change and get my life together and make sure my salvation is secure in Jesus Christ. But that's not the only place I want him to answer me. I don't want him just to answer me when I need him for salvation. I want him to answer me when my world is being turned upside down, when things are coming in like a whirlwind, and I need him. Don't think that just because your soul can be made right with God, but he is much more than just answering the questions of your soul. There are situations that he can still calm the storms in your life. When you're sitting and you're contemplating things, and things are so frustrating, and you want to commit suicide because no answer is coming. We don't want him to be silent then. When my babies are sick, and when my baby has to hold her neck like this, and says, Daddy, Daddy, I want to be able to call upon my God, and he answers me then. I don't want my God to be silent to me because of my ridiculousness. When the whirlwind and things, when your finances are all over the place, and you're fighting and stressed out, we serve a God who we don't want him to be silent in our lives. I'm telling you, church, it's more than just getting your soul right with God, but we serve a God that we don't want him to be silent in different battles in our lives. That's what Saul said. Now the enemy is coming, and I sought you, but there was no answer. I want, Brother Archie, every enemy that comes after me, that the Spirit of the Lord would lift up a standard against him. I want every time my children are sick, that I can pray to the Lord, and the doctor can confirm it and tell me, wow, that was a close one. I don't know what happened, but I thankfully you got her here just in time. That's enough for me to know. I thank the Lord for what the Lord is doing. I want to be able, when my mom calls me and says, I don't know why my feet is swelling up, that I can call on my God and he would not be silent when I petition for something else. You need your God to not be silent when your children, marriages are having problems, when your grandchildren are sick and they're rushing to the hospital room. I don't know why my nephew didn't call upon God. Maybe he's silent to him. I don't know. But thankfully he knew somebody that God wasn't silent to.
Hallelujah.
I tell you, church, in ways it scares me. I know for a fact that I will make it to heaven. I know that I am living my life according to the book, and I'm going to make it to Sequoia. I know that this church is full of people who are going to make it. I am not contemplating my salvation, but my God is much greater than just my Savior. He is my healer. He is my strong tower. He is my friend. He is my comfort. And I don't want him to be silent in those areas of my life. Praise the Lord. So as we stand tonight, see, knocking. The thing is, we only answer when we need him. Because our life is not threatened right now, so we don't need him for the salvation of our soul. I hope you hear what I'm saying to you tonight. Please knock me. Oh God, I come and let me take my coat off first. Oh God, I'm coming. Let me just take care of this first. Oh God, I'm going to let me take care of my bills first. God, I'm gonna get this together, Lord. But let me do one thing at a time. Well, if he's knocking, you better just answer the door. Because obviously he wants your attention right now. Don't double think. Let's lift our hands tonight and love you. Let's lift your hands over this house. There's a sweet presence in this house. Is he knocking tonight? What excuses do we have? He's knocking. Brother Archie, he is knocking. He is knocking at our heart's door. Some of us have already made excuses in our lives. We've already made excuses why we cannot read our Bible. We are already behind and we just started. But he's knocking. He's knocking. Jesus. I pray, Lord, that you would not get tired of me, keep turning my back on you. I pray, Lord, that every time I knock, every time that I will answer the knocks of the Lord in my heart, that when I am in need, I can turn to you, Lord. That when I am in need, that I can turn and call upon the God of my salvation. When things are overwhelmed, that I can call upon you and you can blow the spirit of peace into my life. What is it? What is it that he's knocking on the door about? Are we pleasing him or are we not pleasing him? Are the areas that he is tired over and over again? Reach out to him all over this house. If the word preached hasn't done anything for you, then there's nothing more that I can do for you. There's nothing more that I can do. Reach out to him. You and him. Reach out to him.
You've been so good to me.
It's about how much of God you want in your life. It's no longer about you simply being saved, but it's about how much of Him you want in your life. The reality is there will be some who will go to heaven who will go to heaven. But there will be some who will be mightily used of God before they go to heaven. Your pastor cannot force you to love God. Your pastor cannot force you to desire to submit yourself to God. It's not my job. That doesn't come through a message. You can desire to do something great for God without a single message being preached to you.
Thank you.
just to all make you feel good and to wake you up. To wake you up. I'm God on a lot of this message today. And I'm God on, I didn't want to be offensive to people. But God knew that it looked better. I had no excuse. Supporting our Save My Children. We're going to break our offering this year. We're not going to break it.